So my name is Jean Thomas Harris. I attended Linda McKinley High School from 1968 to 1971. And in 1971, I turned 18 years old in April, and I was a senior in high school.
Turmoil that was happening in the country at large, and what were your thoughts?
As a young person, it was interesting. I grew up watching civil rights. That's the way I frame it. I grew up watching civil rights on television in the late 60s and early 70s, and I always wanted to be a part of that. And I was always curious as to why there weren't lunch counter sit-ins and peace marches in Columbus, Ohio. I think I was a little bit unaware of the Jim Crow laws and how, I was aware of them, but I think I was unaware of how they impacted the North and the South because I lived in a largely segregated neighborhood growing up as an elementary student. So I always wanted to be involved. I always wanted to be one of those activists as I watched everything that was going on in the news in the late 60s and 70s.
Gotcha. So then, can you please talk a little bit about when you came to Linda McKinley High School and how it was changing when you got there?
So I my first year at Linda McKinley High School was 1968. I had gone to Linmore Junior High for 7th, 8th, and 9th grades. And in 1968, when I got to Linda McKinley High School, it was changing. It had become almost a 50-50 school, 50% white, 50% black. And I might not have the percentages exactly right. But the reason that struck me so is because my brother and sister, I have an older brother and an older sister. My brother graduated in 1965, my sister in 1966 from Linda McKinley. When they were at Linda McKinley, it was an all-white school, so much so that my brother, who was very talented, was a singer and a musician, he had a hard time entering into the music program, the elite ensemble music program, even though he had a superior voice, he had some training, because that was kind of reserved for white kids. But by the time I got there in 1968, got to Linden in 1968, the scales were tilting. There were many more black kids than there had been when my brother and sister graduated. So my view of this, of being in advanced classes at Linden, I don't know, was that I think we were isolated from a lot of things. I ran around with a certain group of kids. These were kids that were identified as having a lot of promise. I think that I was isolated from, not totally, but to a certain extent, at least I was, and maybe it was because I was a girl also. I mean, because that gender thing also enters into it. But I think I was isolated from a lot of the conversations that were happening with kids who were not in the advanced class, the kids who were deemed as more militant. I think my husband had, he wasn't my husband then, but I think my husband had a little different experience, and I think it was because he was a male and probably in sports. And I was a girl and doing girl things. And, you know, gosh, I hate saying that right now, but that was the reality.
I see. Well, that makes sense for sure. Can you talk about your experience as senior class vice president, and what that was like and who you were kind of serving with?
Yeah, that was an interesting situation. The senior class president who was elected was a white male, and he was also in some of the honors classes or advanced classes that I was in. I served as senior class vice president, And the other three officers, as I now think about it, they were all three of the vice president, the secretary, and the treasurer. Carolyn Coulter, what was Bythewood's first name, do you remember?
Brenda.
What was it?
Brenda.
Brenda Bythewood, and then myself as vice president. We were all three black females, but the president was a white male. And I remember the conversation around that. The white kids all got together and voted for Jim Johnson. And there were enough of them to vote in a block. I think there was somebody else who ran as president. I don't remember who it was. But there were enough of them as a block that they voted Jim Johnson, who was probably the quietest guy in school, as senior class president. And then three black females were the other officers. It was very interesting.
Did you work well together?
I don't even remember it. You know what I'm saying? I know that we must have pulled off some things together, but I think the more active group was student council, of which my husband, he wasn't my husband then, was president. And so, you know, I think we pulled off things like the prom and homecoming and that kind of thing, but I don't remember us doing a lot of things, actually.
Okay. Thank you. And so last question for now is, can you tell us about Jane Jacobson? Who was she and what made her special? And so I was going to say, and Mr. Harris, if you want to actually jump in on this, I'm not sure if you were familiar with her as well.
Oh, yeah, very much so.
Yeah, okay, so feel free. Thank you.
So Jane Jacobson was an iconic person at Lynn McKinley High School. She was the school librarian. She was a white female woman from Kansas, of all places. And she built the largest black history collection in the city of Columbus, in any high school in the city of Columbus. She was much beloved. The library was on the third floor. And there were several of us who would not have a day that we did not make our way to that third floor, that library, to see Jane Jacobson. Why did we go? One, because Ms. J was, and as we called her affectionately, Ms. J, she was so encouraging about everything, and she wanted to see us, especially those of us who were in honors classes and advanced classes, really do our best. I mean, she was better than any counselor that we ever could have had at that school. And she, when you went in there, you knew you were going to get an assignment. I read the autobiography of Malcolm X. I read Richard Wright's books. I read Ralph Ellison's book. I was introduced to those books by Jane Jacobson. We did have a Black History class at the school at that time, but she was one who really got me personally interested in reading African American literature. She was the most beloved individual professional in that school.
She also worked with all of the Ohio colleges and several colleges from around the country to come in and actually present themselves and their schools to students.
Mm-hmm.
And she would invite various students in, depending on which colleges were coming in, to sit down, hear their pitch, talk a little bit about what they wanted to do in college and so forth. And that's how a lot of us really got in school, to be honest. I mean, there are a lot of kids who probably weren't even thinking about going to college, but because she asked them to come in and sit in on some of those sessions, decided that maybe this was the right course that I wanted to take.
Tell about how you ended up at Notre Dame.
Well, that's not one of, she may want to question that later.
Sorry.
I ended up going to Notre Dame. It was really two things. One, I was on a merit scholars recruiting program, which Notre Dame participated in. So I was getting literature from them. But they were recruiting another student at Linden. And he ultimately won the Joyce Scholarship, which was full paid. But as they were coming in to interview him, she insisted that they interview other kids
mm-hmm.
in school. And so I got invited to one of those sessions and mentioned to the guy that I was in a recruiting program. And so the recruiter basically took my name and information, and we talked about me coming up for a weekend, and he made the arrangements for me to come up and visit and literally walk me through the whole admission process. And then once I got admitted and started, and she applied the next year, he walked her through the admission process as well. So it worked out very well. But it really started with Miss J.
Exactly.
Awesome. Wow. That's a lot.
Yeah.
And some of your classmates definitely have mentioned her. So thank you for giving even more insight. So Mr. Harris, if you could start off by stating your name and the years you attended Lyndon McKinley, how old you were and what grade in 1971.
Okay. My name is Stanley Eugene Harris. I attended Lyndon McKinley from 1968 to 1971. I turned 18 in May of 1971 as a senior.
Okay, and same question. As a youth, were you aware of the political and social turmoil in the country at the time? And if so, what were your thoughts?
Certainly, like Gene, I was aware of the whole civil rights movement. Watched it, a lot of it on TV. I remember in elementary school going through some of the atomic bomb processes. That stopped after elementary school, quite frankly, but we knew the Vietnam War had started and was raging. A lot of commentary about that. So we were definitely aware of those.
And what about protests and sort of civil rights protests and I guess racial justice? I don't know if people were using the term then, but.
Yeah, as far as the protests were concerned, you know, we saw those happen around the country, not only the peaceful protests, but all the rioting in all your urban areas. And like Gene said, you kind of wondered why Columbus was getting left out. But we weren't quite the major city, if you will, that the Detroits and Chicago's and even Newark, New Jersey's and Washington, D.C., some of those areas. We knew there were more black folks living there, and just attributed that to the fact that we didn't have as many black folk here.
I see. And can you talk about living in Lyndon as a child and what effects you saw from urban renewal?
I don't think urban renewal affected Lyndon as much. The neighborhood I lived in before, which was Flytown, basically got torn down because of urban renewal. And most of the people who lived in Flytown actually moved to Windsor. I mean, it was quite a few of them. And so most of the urban renewal work was really more downtown than it was in the neighborhoods. In the same way with the freeway, as those were being constructed here, it really didn't affect where we lived much at all.
So can you talk about the destruction of the place that you lived before, but also can you just sort of talk about Windsor Terrace? And for the audience who wouldn't necessarily know what it is, just tell us what it is, what was.
Okay. Yeah, when I lived in Flytown was literally destroyed. It was demolished for urban renewal. They were building a stretch of I-670 over there, and then mostly apartments that were all newly constructed after they demolished Flytown. Most of the residents in Flytown, like I said, we moved to Windsor Terrace, which was a public housing community, and when we moved in, they were still building houses, and even the elementary school was not completely finished, but it was open and, you know, obviously conducting classes. So.
And can you tell us what were the demographics, or how did the demographics at Lyndon McKinley change from the time you started to the time you left? Mm-hmm. And do you think that there were racial tensions as a result of those changes?
Well, the demographics were at Linden when we got there, I think Gene mentioned that it was about 50-50, but having started in Windsor when I was in the first grade, I literally saw the color line move north over the years, so that by the time I got to Linden, the area immediately around Linden was no longer a white area. It was predominantly black.
Mm-hmm.
And the color line really had moved almost a mile north of there. The tensions, I think, came, one, and Gene alluded to the music area. I played in the band, was also an athlete. And most of your athletic teams, the band was pretty much black. We still have white band members all 3 years that I marched in the marching band, but every year it got a little bit more black or less white. And so I think the tension just became where the white kids begin to feel like they couldn't participate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they could do their thing in the classroom, but with a lot of the extracurricular activities, they were just getting blanked out, because all the athletic teams, by the time I was a senior, I think they were all they were all black. There were no white members on the athletic teams.
I see. So I want to move to early 1971, and this is a question for both of you. Can you describe the Black History Week performance that happened in February of 1971, and talk about what happened during that performance? And then I'll have a couple of separate follow-up questions, but if you could both kind of talk about what you saw, what you witnessed, what you experienced.
Yeah.
So this Black History Assembly as in 1971, as I remember it, had been something that had been planned for a while. It was an all-school assembly. People were so excited about it. And as I remember it, it was giving kind of a panoramic view of the history of African Americans in the United States. That's what I kind of remembered. Mm-hmm. You remember it being that? And so there were a lot of people involved, performers, music, poetry, singing, dancing. I mean, and people, students really took pride in this and were very excited. Obviously, there had been some teachers who had helped to produce it. I don't remember who and how. It might have been our Black history teacher. Stan probably remembers all of that detail. But Lyndon McKinley at that time had 2,000 students. Our graduating class was 400. So in 1971, there were between 1,800 and 2,000 students who were attending the school, graduating class of 400 students. Our auditorium would seat all of those. So we're talking 2,000 kids in the auditorium, in the balcony, on the main floor, packed. It was packed. Black kids excited, thinking everybody was excited. In the middle of the program, it might have been right at the beginning mm-hmm. of the program, an individual student that we knew, Rick Warren, threw some papers over the side of the balcony, disrupted the entire program. There were boys that ran after him, chasing him out of the auditorium. The program itself was disrupted. It just blew up. And it was disappointing for me when we found out that it was somebody that we knew. The papers basically said kind of some things that Stan had said previously, and that is that we as white kids, we're being shut out of everything. We're not in the leadership. When we go to the office, we get unequal discipline. You know, black kids will get a slap on the wrist, we'll get suspended. I think that's hilarious, you know, knowing what the statistics are now with black and brown kids being suspended from school and being unduly suspended from school and disciplined, but it was a whole, it was a page of grievances. Here are our grievances. You know, this was our school and now it's not our school and these people have come in. I mean, these were not the words necessarily, but this was what was communicated. And that did not go over well. Stan, did you want to add anything to that?
No, I think the only thing I would add is obviously we did know who did it at the time that it was happening. But I agree with Gene. There was a lot of excitement about this because it was the first time the school had ever done it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think at the time we might have been the only high school who actually had the Black History Assembly. I don't mm-hmm. think any of the other high schools did. So, I mean, we knew this was a big deal. But I don't think anybody had anticipated that the white kids would be rebelling against this.
Mm-hmm.
And there clearly was no indication from the faculty that we needed to be aware that there may be some problems. They didn't seem apprehensive about it. So this whole incident became a real shock to the system, if you will, for everybody from the principal on down, that it happened and that the school just at that point just kind of blew up.
And I guess I'd just like to bring in an additional perspective. Either they didn't know or they ignored it. I mean, just, you know, having lived my life as an educational professional, you know, either they didn't know or somebody knew and somebody didn't. Because I can't imagine that there were no white kids in that whole school that weren't talking to some adult about how they were feeling, about how things were going. Now, they might not have known. I don't believe that they knew that Rick Warren was going to do what he did, you know, that the assembly was going to be disrupted. But just thinking back on it, you know, as a professional, somebody had to know that something, that kids were feeling a certain way and that it ought to be dealt with.
And Mr. Harris, can you share with us what Rick Warren told you when you saw him later? And how much later was it when you had this conversation?
This was a couple of years later. He was a maitre d' at a restaurant that Gene and I had gone to for dinner, and came over. And, you know, I think Rick and I had played Little League football together, so we went way back. And so he saw me in the restaurant, walked over, and we spoke. And he said, "Look, man, I just need to apologize. I was one of those behind what happened in that assembly. I regret what I did, but was heavily influenced by my parents, who had become members of the John Birch Society at the time. And I completely reject what they stand for and all of that. I've gone through some changes with them, but, you know, just want you guys to know that I really regret what we did and the damage that we caused."
Wow.
Right.
Wow. Yeah, I actually, just as a footnote, in preparation for this, I was aware of the John Birch Society, but I went to their website the other day, and it's, you know, on their homepage, they have a banner with some people, like photograph of a group, and you know they have a black woman on that banner. And I was like, "Why?" And I thought about you too. I thought about this conversation. It's, wow. So, Mr. Harris, you were, and I might have the office wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. You were student body president in 1971.
Correct.
Okay. And was that student council or?
Yeah, student council and student body president was one and the same. Yeah.
Oh. Okay. I see. And can you talk about that and talk about how you, if you had a response, if you responded to this incident with the flyers in your official capacity?
No, I would say there was no response other than, you know, when it happened, I ran out in the hall and eventually ran into the music room to see what was going on. I mean, because kids were running out of the building, and there were some fights on the grounds. But most of the kids were just getting chased up and down the streets. You know, most of the white kids had left. black kids ran after them. They were mad. And so I had just gone out to see what was going on, and I left. I was in the music room probably no more than 10 or 15 minutes. I went to the office after that, and in fact, I think Gene and I both ended up in the office, and with both the principal and the two vice principals were in there, and we started talking about what was going on, and the principal had mentioned that he had called down to central office, and that they were sending the police, and just as he was saying that, the police showed up, and they showed up in riot gear and just completely surrounded the school. And basically, I think whoever was in charge of the police at the time came in and basically said, we need to evacuate the building. And so at that point, the principal and vice principal told us we needed to leave and get out. And they were going up the hallways to help evacuate the building. The police came in, and they were walking up and down the halls telling kids to go home.
I see. And when you went back into the hallways, what was the general, was it chaos? Was it?
Yes. Yeah, people were, had gone to their lockers to get their coats and books, and we basically did the same thing, and then we were ready to go home, like everybody else. And I think by the time we actually walked out of the building, I'd say it was probably 90% vacated by that time. There weren't very many people left in the building.
I see. So I'm gonna move forward a little bit into the year, to the springtime, and I want to talk about the March to Franklin Park in May. And if you could, I think you both went to that, you attended. So if you could both kind of speak to your experience, what you saw, what happened there, and what the march on the way was like.
Yeah, we didn't actually participate in the march itself. I had my older brother's car for the day, and so she and I decided not to march, but to go ahead and drive down there. So that's what we did.
This is why I didn't remember the march, because I didn't march. I rode. I rode to the revolution. That's what I did. I had a ride to the revolution.
But we basically got down to the park, and obviously we got down there a little early, at least before the kids from Linden had gotten there. And there were some kids from other high schools some were there, and obviously some came afterwards. But it was really just a gathering. I think at that point there were some community leaders who were primed to give speeches, and they had some musical groups out there for entertainment. And it literally lasted all day long. We didn't stay all day. I think we ended up leaving, pretty much about the time we would normally get out of school. Was the time that we left, but it was more of a festive situation. But also, some of the speeches were fiery in terms of it's a typical protest stuff that something needed to change.
And it was interesting as I think about this and remember, the one high school that was the all black high school in town, historic East High School, that was directly across the street from the park, that principal told those students that they could not attend.
In fact, locked the doors.
Locked the doors and said, you won't graduate, you won't get to go on to college. And they sent lots of kids to college. And just as, again, as I think about this as a professional, just looking backwards, what a wonderful learning experience that would have been if they had been able to walk across the school street with their teachers, with their principals, to actually hear and take part in this historic moment. But, yeah. We all live and learn.
Yeah, the vice principals marched with the students to the park.
The Linda McKinley.
Yeah, and I think there were some of the teachers also participated.
And who, can you name the vice principals who marched with you?
Yeah, the vice principals were Tom Brown and
Terry Steele.
Okay. Okay. So I wanted to, Dr. Harris, you mentioned something that happened on your 15th birthday. And so I wondered if you could talk about, you know, you mentioned in the beginning always wanting to be a part of movements and protests. And so you mentioned this event that happened on your 15th birthday was when I asked you about this march, the rally at Franklin Park before. So could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, you know, the rally at Franklin Park had particular meaning to me because I had always wanted to be a part of protest and the movement and really changing things for black people. And I think one of the things that impacted me most in my life that continued to make me want to do that is that Martin Luther King actually was murdered on my 15th birthday. And I'll never forget that moment. You know, it's one of those things where, you know, people ask you, do you remember where you were when John Kennedy got shot? Well, I remember exactly what I was doing on that day. My grandparents had come to our house. We were having birthday cake and ice cream. The TV was on, and we heard that Martin Luther King had been murdered at the Lorraine Hotel in Memphis. And I think that right at that moment, I just knew that I was supposed to do something to help people. Didn't know. I thought that I was going to be, I don't know, a freedom rider or something. Somebody was going to let me be a freedom rider somewhere, but it really turned into my career in education. I think so. And I think it was solidified then.
Wow. That's incredible. So Mr. Harris, you kind of already answered this question. I was going to ask you about the black takeover that you mentioned, and I think you talked about that a little bit. If there's anything you want to add, please do. And then, Dr. Harris, if you could talk about the divide. You mentioned the divide between black students, and I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the only thing I would mention in regards to the quote-unquote black takeover of Lyndon was that this was not a forced kind of thing. All the athletic teams had tryouts. At that time, most of the coaches were still white. And, you know, the band director was white. The choir music director was white. So this was not an issue where, you know, black faculty comes in and decides, you know, we're only gonna recruit black kids for the activities. It just happened that way. And part of it too was just white kids kind of withdrawing on their own, deciding that I don't want to be bothered with these guys. And so they kind of separated themselves. But there was that element among the white students who got along with, mingled with, socialized with black kids. They were just a minority. The majority of white kids didn't. Yeah. And they segregated themselves and really just kind of did their own thing. And so some of their actions during this period, starting with the Black History program, caught everybody off guard because this was not something that would have been talked about between black kids and white kids at all. We didn't see that coming.
Yeah, and I think that there was, Stan had talked about a little bit earlier, there was a geographical divide that emerged from what was going on. I think that South Lyndon ended, and the area right around the high school ended up being, and just a little north of that, probably all the way to Hudson, maybe to Weber Road,
right,
ended up being very, very black. And then, and when before, as Stan had said, it had been pretty white. All of Lyndon had been white. And then North Lyndon, you know, remained white for a
right.
while. And so there was this major geographical divide. And then there was another divide, and that was a divide, certainly in our class of 400, between students. And that divide has remained, and now we'll be out of school 50 years next year. We'll celebrate our 50th graduation anniversary next year. And the divide that exists now is between the white kids and the black kids in that class. Not all. I mean, I don't ever want to be recorded saying one of my best friends is white. However, there are four of us that are very good friends, two white, two black, and we Zoom, since COVID, we have been Zooming every month, just about. And we, three of us are here in town, and one is in, where is she?
Arizona.
No, she's in Missouri. She's in the Ozarks. Isn't that where, Ozarks in Missouri. She's in Missouri. But we talk at least once a month. And this summer, it was even more often than that. But that is not typical of our class. Our class is divided. The reunions, we try really hard to get the white kids to come. And there are a handful of white kids who do come, but there's so many more that are in the class. And unfortunately, I think because of mishandling, and they didn't know. I don't think they mishandled it because they willfully did it, but mishandling by adults, our class ended up divided. We didn't have conversations that would heal us. Nobody thought about, after graduation, keeping the conversations going and what the impact would be. And then I think another issue that Stan brought up when he talked about Rick Warren and what influenced him is that a lot of our classmates probably were influenced by their parents. And that if we could talk to them today, because we have talked to, remember it was Jim Johnson that right. we had lunch with last year. He lives in Texas now, but he was in Columbus and we had lunch. We could talk to them today, their whole perspective would be different.
Right.
Because they've grown and they're not just under the influence of whatever it is their parents were under the influence during that time. And it's just sad to me that there was no one who decided to be the adult in the room and make sure that these young people heal, that this tragic situation didn't end up just being tragic forever.
Thank you for that. So I want to ask you both about this group of black students who were, for all intents and purposes, were activists within the school, met, and I think, Mr. Harris, you referred to you all as the Black Student Union. and so, you know, and I'm talking about the group that included John Wells yeah. and John Whitaker and Mark Morton and Valora Washington. And so can you talk about the group, talk about why you met, and I guess where you met, and what you were interested in, like what your focus was?
Well, first of all, I was not one of the founders, so the group had actually started, had been meeting for a while. I don't know how long they had been meeting, but they had been meeting for a while when I got invited to attend. And, you know, we met in different places, but John Wells lived with his uncle, and we had quite a few of the meetings over there. There were a few meetings in school, as I recall. But there were also meetings in some of the other students' homes or, you know, backyards or whatever. And basically met really to just talk about what was going on or not going on in school. What were some of the things that we would, if we could change things, what were some of the things that we wanted to see changed? And, of course, those ended up being demands that we wanted to give to the administration. But there was, at that time, there was clearly an inference that there were some outside forces that were meeting with at least some of the students in the union separately. And I wasn't privy to that, and so didn't know how often that was taking place. But I knew that it was happening, and they were kind of dictating the tone of the meetings.
So can you talk to that to whatever extent you feel comfortable?
Sure. I mean, I'm only going to tell you what I know. I don't, you know, like I said, because I wasn't involved in those meetings, I don't know who all the people were, but I do know that you know, there were people up at Ohio State that were meeting with, here at Ohio State, that were meeting with some of the kids.
Was Charles Ross one of them?
Charles Ross was definitely one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And how do you think, how did that influence play itself out in the tone of your meetings with your peers?
Well, I think there was a real strong push to do something to get attention. And that ended up being it was going to be a stage sit-in. And again, a lot of the quote-unquote logistics of that, I think, got discussed outside of the regular meetings, which I was not privy to. But there was a lot of debate back and forth. As I remembered it, we probably went through the last two or three meetings that I attended included discussions about the sit-in, and ultimately the group decided that we weren't going to do that. That we called it off.
And so, two things. One, do you recall why the decision was made to call it off? And the other question I would have right now is, what were the demands? You mentioned to me a few specific things, a couple of specific things that you all wanted. And could you talk a little bit about those?
Yeah, some of the demands, probably the most radical one was to put the black flag up and fly it along with the American flag out front of the school. We kind of knew that wasn't going to happen, but it was on the list. But I think the one that we all wanted more than anything else was more black history taught in the curriculum, and to make that available in the evenings for parents who might have an interest in doing that, which we subsequently were able to get it up and get that going. There were classes offered. In fact, my mother took one. I think she was in the first class that they offered, and that was successful for a while. Anyway.
And who taught the evening classes for the parents?
We had two. I think at that time they were either first year or maybe they were in their second year classes. There were two black males, Mr. Bunch and Mr. Davis, who taught those classes on a volunteer basis. They weren't being paid for it.
Okay. Dr. Harris, did you want to add anything?
No, I never was invited to those meetings. It's just interesting to listen to Stan talk about those meetings, because I think there was another divide, and there was a divide between within, the African-American students. So there were those who were seen as more radical thinking, and then there were the good kids. You know, don't talk to her because, she's not gonna understand this. This is gonna be above her head. So, I wasn't one of those that I was in classes with Valora Washington. And we were in classes together, but I was one of the persona non gratas. I think it's great. I mean, just as a career educator, you just see different groups of kids and how they grow and mature and think about life, and some come into their own. I was reading the books that Jane Jacobson gave me to try to figure out who I was. I did want to be a part of sit-ins and all of that, but I really wanted to know who I was, as a black person. So I was more concentrating on that than, some of the larger policy issues. That came later in my life.
Gotcha. I like that persona non grata.
That was me.
So I want to ask you both your memories of the flag actually being switched in the front. Just looking back at some of the press at the time, and I know this was a while ago, it appears that the flag was switched, it was taken down, and then there were black students who I'm presuming were part of the Black Student Union group, who still wanted that flag to fly. And at one point, there was a faculty meeting where the faculty actually were in support of the red, black, and green flag flying in front as well. But the administration, the superintendent specifically, made it very clear that the only flags that would fly would be the American flag and the Ohio flag. So do you have a memory of the incident where the flag was switched and seeing it in front of the school, or no?
I don't have that memory. In fact, when you and I chatted initially, when you told me that was the first time I had been made aware of it. So like I said, I remember us having the discussions. I knew it was one of the demands, but did not know that it was actually staged to go up.
And I have a vague memory of it actually happening. I don't have a lot of memory about it. I feel like I was outside and there were a crowd of people and it happened. And I'm not quite sure what happened after that, but I know it wasn't good. Whatever happened right after that was not good.
Have any further or any specific memories of Charles Ross and his presence at Linda McKinley or influence beyond what you mentioned thus far, if you have any memories of him or even memories of him kind of at large? For example, was he at the Malcolm X rally? Do you remember him speaking there? Whatever memories you have.
Yeah, I don't know whether he spoke there or not. I don't remember him speaking, but he very well could have and probably did speak there, to be honest with you, because like I said, there were a number of community leaders, some of whom I didn't know much about, who spoke. There were no student speakers at that rally, so they were all adults. I didn't know Dr. Ross. I knew of him. I knew he was up here at Ohio State teaching in the Black Studies Department. But
social work.
And social work. I also knew that I'd seen him in and out of Linden meeting with the administrator. So I knew he was definitely engaged. But that was about the extent of it for me.
And same here. I had that memory that Stan has of Dr. Ross coming in and out of Linden. I even vaguely remember having a discussion with him at Linden. I couldn't tell you what it was about. But my most cogent memory of him is I had his youngest son, when I was principal at Mifflin High School, I had his youngest son as a student there, Attorney Marcus Ross, who is attorney now here in town. And I remember talking to Dr. Ross, you know, obviously about Marcus, and Dr. Ruth Ross, his wife, but also just a little bit about Lyndon and, you know, what he was trying to accomplish and just really trying to raise awareness of us, for us, and with us, and trying to raise awareness in the community about Black people. And he had, I just remember him having a bigger than life kind of, it seemed to me in my mind, personality here at Ohio State in the School of Social Work. I mean, it wasn't always, people didn't always speak of him positively, not because he wasn't an excellent professor, but because he was always trying to push the envelope, always trying to make things better, always trying to make them more relevant. And he was always, he was not on the cutting edge, he was on the leading edge, you know, of some things. So that's my memory of Dr. Ross.
I see. Thank you for that, that insight. Can you both talk about the impact of having a Black vice principal and the two Black teachers, Mr. Gary Davis and Bruce Bunch, in your school? How do you think that impacted not only yourselves specifically and personally, but also other Black students at the school?
I think Tom Brown inspired a lot of us who became educators to continue on that path. I knew I wanted to be an educator, but to continue on that path. And then I could see there was nothing in my brain that told me that I couldn't. I love teaching, so I don't want it to sound like I left teaching so that I hated the classroom, and so I became an administrator. But there wasn't anything that made me think that I couldn't do that. I saw Tom Brown do that, and I knew Tom Brown, and I still know Tom Brown. But it wasn't only him. It was Terry Steele too, who was white. I mean, these were relatively young administrators, which you didn't see in our day that you would have young administrators vibrant like that. These were vibrant men. And my guess is they were probably in their 40s, maybe, in their 30s.
I would say late 30s.
Late 30s, yeah. early 40s. And so there they were. And same for Bruce and Gary. They were in their 20s. And so we had at... The elementary school that I went to was a segregated elementary school on the east side of Columbus. I went to Garfield Elementary School. And so I had all black teachers. My principal was black. The custodian was black. Everybody was black. I got to Lynmore, and it was culture shock. Everybody was white. Mr. Gill was our counselor. He was black. And there might have been a couple other... Verna Woods, Adams, Mrs. Mm-hmm. Adams... she was our English teacher. She was black. But look, I'm naming them. I'm picking them off. And so having somebody like Tom Brown and Gary Davis and Bruce in leadership roles as teachers and administrators were very inspiring to us. And we all took their classes.
Right.
We definitely took their classes.
Yeah. And they weren't the only black teachers. I mean, we had other black teachers there. But they were older, had been teaching for a number of years.
True.
They were kind of the new breed. And Lyndon at that time, I mean, I think one of the issues that came up after all of this blew over was that the staff was a very young, was a fairly young staff. A lot of the teachers who had taught at Lyndon for years were retiring, and they were being replaced by fairly new teachers.
That's true.
And, some parents weren't that particularly happy about that because they were young, some of them were black, and so that became another issue for particularly the white students.
I see. So I just have a couple more questions, and I want to leave some room because I'm almost sure that Alan probably has a couple questions for you, and Simone may as well. So I'm gonna bring this to a close. One. Dr. Harris, could you talk about being an administrator? You were superintendent of Columbus City Schools. Could you talk about that? And then from that vantage point, say a bit about how you feel the situation at Lyndon was handled in 1971. And then I have a final question for both of you, but if you could go ahead with that.
I had a 37-year career in education, the last 12 of which I spent as superintendent of Columbus City Schools. So what an honor to be superintendent in the school district from which you graduated. So I have a unique perspective on looking back at that situation at Lyndon McKinley. And if I could have advised the principal at that time and the superintendent at that time, it would have been to sit down and talk with students. Let's find someone and staff who can facilitate discussion about not only how we're feeling, but how and why we're feeling the way we're feeling, but where do we go from here? I mean, we needed a safe space for black kids and white kids to talk about why they were where they were, why they felt the way they felt, why they acted the way they did, and how do we go forward as the beloved community. That never happened at Lyndon, and I will tell you, because it didn't happen at Lyndon, I think Lyndon is forever scarred. We as a professional, we did everything we could to pull Lyndon back together. It is a newly, beautifully renovated building with state-of-the-art technology, up-to-date. We have had a difficult time finding the right leadership for Lyndon, being able to reach out to the community. And I think it's not the only reason, but I think one of the primary reasons is because Lyndon never healed. it never healed from that situation. And so I wish I could have been a fly on the wall or somehow had some experience to advise folks, let's talk about it, let's heal it, let's be deliberate and intentional about it. And unfortunately, that never happened.
But I think one of the stumbling blocks was that so many of the white kids transferred immediately after the incident to Brookhaven and
Northland.
But Brookhaven probably got the bulk of the kids.
Yeah. But I even think, even with that, if it had become a community healing, because mm-hmm. they transferred, but they didn't necessarily move.
Oh, no, they didn't.
They were still living. Exactly. they were still living in that community.
Yeah.
And we didn't work hard enough to heal the community.
I see. That definitely, that puts it in perspective, you mm-hmm. know, that they were still living in the community but weren't there at the school any longer. So my final question for both of you is just kind of bringing it back to today. And when you see protests against police brutality and demonstrations, you know, that are happening where people are protesting systemic racism, particularly this year, you know, things have really, you know, come to the fore this year in a way that hadn't happened in a while. Do you see parallels to what happened at Lyndon in 1971 or the years that you were there? And what are your thoughts?
Well, I certainly still see the military approach to controlling the situation. That day, it was something that I had never seen before live. You know, you saw the police show up in riot gear and during the riots and that kind of stuff. But again, that was New York, that was Chicago, that was L.A., that wasn't Columbus. When they showed up at Lyndon McKinley in full riot gear, I mean, and then they got turned loose to come into the school to evacuate the school. I mean, these guys had guns and everything, and that was a frightening situation. It really was, and I still see that today, where it's just it's over the top approach to let's intimidate our way through this, and we'll get rid of all this problem, and it needs to change.
I completely agree with Stan on the current militaristic approach, as it was at Lyndon, to protest. The other thing that I also see, however, is that there are suburban white young people who have become a part of these protests. And I am praying, which was not what we had at Lyndon McKinley. So that was the opposite of what we had at Lyndon McKinley. What I'm praying is that they are taking responsibility for addressing the effects of systemic racism. To me, it's ridiculous for us to think that as African Americans that we're going to address that, because so much of the power, the policy power, the money, you know, the economic power, all of those things are not in our hands. You know, I'm not saying that we are hopeless and powerless and that we can't do anything. I'm not saying that we need to walk away from it. But, you know, just like I was saying that I was reading those books to learn about who I was and who I was going to be as a person, that's what white folks need to do.
Mm-hmm.
They need to, those white kids, and I'm praying that they are thinking in this way, who are out there in those protests, they need to figure out who they are and who they want to be in this country and what it is that they're going to do to make sure that this does not continue. I mean, we all know that race is a social construct. We had to define who people are. However, I mean, we are people underneath, and we've got feelings, and I'm hurt by this stuff. As a African American woman, every time I see a George Floyd or a Breonna Taylor or Ahmaud Arbery or any of those things, that touches me personally. Because together, Stan and I have a son who has three of the the greatest kids ever. So I've got a son and a daughter-in-law and three grandkids, and I've got nieces and nephews. So every time I see that, that hurts me personally. So I need somebody else to be in this fight too. So I'm just prayerful that these white kids and white adults and others that are in this fight are taking on the responsibility personally and corporately like we are and have had to.
Yeah, and I would add that this playbook has not just been a black-white thing. I mean, America has used this playbook around the world. And you just see us getting off our state-of-the-art, fighter jets and showing up in riot gear. Regular military gear. But, I mean, we walk in trying to intimidate and walk over people. And that just doesn't work anymore.
Wow. Well, thank you both so, so much. We so appreciate, this has been wonderful, and I really thank you. And you both answered so well. I was concerned about the time, because I know I sent you both of you had big lists of questions. I'm glad we were able to do this. So I'm going to ask Alan and Simone if you all have any questions for the Harrises.
Hello. Yes, I do have questions. Just give me a second to unmute. But this is incredible. This was such an incredible interview. And I don't know if Simone would like to go first. That's fine. If not, I do have a couple of questions I'd like to ask you.
You can go first.
Thank you. I'm going to switch to gallery view so you can see me. So this was really an incredible interview. And there's so many questions I'd like to ask. But with the time that we have, I'd just like to ask you to consider talking with me again, maybe over Zoom like this at another time, if you're available for it. But I'm really interested in, especially with all the folks who participated in the relationship between their literacy practices and their participation in activism and leadership. Mm. But really, you said several things that were just, frankly, Celia knew I had questions. I was excited. You could tell I was like jumping around the background, right? Because some of the things that you said. And so, but again, I really want to be respectful of your time. And so the first question I generally would ask people is, could you talk to me about how your literacy, I'm really interested in the intersection between literacy practices and activism. And I'd ask you, well, how did the things that you read affect you or lead you to become engaged in activism?
Yeah.
And so I'd like to tease that out. I'd like to have you talk about it. But then Dr. Harris, you also talked about how you read to find, you linked up literacy practices and identity, right? Mm-hmm. And so I was really excited about that. That was really powerful. You talked about how you read Invisible Man, right, by Ellison. You talked about how you read, I'm guessing, The Fire Next Time, mm-hmm. right? And you talked specifically, you mentioned the title, The Autobiography of Malcolm X.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to ask you, did your reading impact, one, either your involvement in the activism and then later your work as an educator?
Mm-hmm. And the answer is yes. Yeah, And my literacy practices still impact, what I do. Even though I've been retired for 7 years out of education, but my reading inspires me to want to work with other people and to share information with them also. If you don't know who you are and what you're about and where you've come from, you can't begin to know what your purpose is, on this earth. And so, reading has led me in that direction too. It has obviously led me into a career of education, wanting to give as much as I possibly could to young people so that they have opportunities beyond, any opportunity I may have had, that their minds, reading for me opens up your minds to the possibilities of things that you may have never thought were possible. And it also gives you confidence that, yes, I can make these things work. If this guy who came out of this ghetto can become this individual and lead people, then certainly I can with the experiences that I've had. So reading for me is inspiring and keeps me want to move forward. And it also keeps me young. I mean, I'm determined I'm not going to get old. I'm old, but I'm just determined I'm not going to get old. I'm just not going to do it.
Yeah, I would add to that. I know a couple of the books that I read also, in addition to some of the stuff that Gene had read, Up from Slavery and mm-hmm. Souls of Black Folk mm-hmm. with W.E.B. Du Bois. And I still remember in one of my, and I think it was our Problems of Democracy class, POD, classes, we split up into teams and kind of had a debate between those who favored Booker T. Washington's
and W.E.B.
Versus W.E.B. Du Bois. Yeah. I mean, that was, for me, that was enlightening.
Yeah.
And in reading the books, I really had not traveled outside of Ohio. I mean, I went to California once, but aside from that, the rest of the United States was just, it was just out there. And so the reading helped you broaden your understanding mm-hmm. of a wider world and the way other people, particularly other Black people, lived. Because those were different situations than the situation you were growing up in. I mean, I was in poverty, grew up in a housing project, but that's a whole different thing than rural poverty that so many of our people had come through. And I was totally unaware prior to reading books like that of the Black migration. I didn't know how Black people got to Ohio, but I just knew that we were here. And so that just opened up a whole different world, a different line of thinking, from that regard.
And when you think about young people today, who I'm just going to give you an example. A few years into my superintendency, had a group of young people in the governor's mansion. I'm trying to think of the last Democratic governor. It was
Celeste.
No.
It was
Strickland.
Yeah.
And with Governor Strickland, and it was a whole deal on Black boys, and the whole thing brought some kids from the Afrocentric school, which at that time was located in the old Mohawk school down at Livingston and Grant. And so just going to Bexley was just blocks away. We weren't talking 15 minutes. And a young man said, "Where am I? I'm in another city. I've never been, just blocks away." So what reading does is exactly what Stan said. It opens up the mind to what the possibilities mm-hmm. are, and that you can see yourself. You can actually see yourself situated in some of these situations. So it's just so important. It's important to living.
Wow, thank you. You know, I was going to ask you those questions separately, but I'm really glad that we did it that way, because it was so much more effective than my way. Because I was going to ask you, Mr. Harris, the same thing, but I really love the way, so I'd like to go just a little bit further with this too. So, Dr. Harris, you talked about Jane Jacobs, right? Am I saying your name?
Jane.
Jane Jacobs. And you talked about what an impact she had, right? And she kind of selected you guys. What? How did that happen? Can you talk about that? Like, what? How did she identify you? How did you identify her as a resource? How did that relationship get started? Where she pulled you aside and started to offer you books, or were you looking for them?
I was always a reader, and so I think that I went to the library doing study halls, because there were these things called mm-hmm. study halls in those days. And it gave me an opportunity to hang out with him too. So if we went to the library, we could sit together. In study hall, you couldn't sit together. So, you know, there was an ulterior motive to that. And, but Miss J, she knew who the promising students were. I mean, and don't get me wrong, she didn't separate the sheep from the goats. I mean, it wasn't like she wasn't talking to all of the kids, but I think she put special emphasis on individuals who, you know, were in honors classes and that kind of thing. So I didn't seek her out. I went to the library, and then I was a consistent one in the library. And because of that, I got to know her. She got to know me. And one of the reasons she got to know me is because I was always talking in the library. And so I can remember her saying this, in order to keep you from talking, read this book. And so she just started handing us books. And we started reading books.
But nobody, went to the library with any regularity that she didn't
that she know, didn't know.
And she didn't get to know a fair amount about you in terms of what she wanted to do and so forth. And like I said, she was sponsoring these schools to come in. And I think she did it with the other counselors, the high school counselors at Linden. But I mean, there were a number of hundreds of colleges, literally, that came through Linden over that three-year period that we were there. And, you know, you would get invited. You were excused from class to go and sit in on those sessions and, you know, helped you make up. Well, it, first of all, it gave you a selection of schools to even think about. And then, obviously, gave you the opportunity to network with these counselors for them to connect with you, and if they thought that you were a student that was pretty seriously interested, they would go out of their way to try to make arrangements to get you oriented to the school and talk about the application process and so forth.
I see. So she really, thank you for kind of exploring that. I was going to talk to you about what happened with the colleges. I thought that was really interesting. I want to share something with you. So I had graduated my undergrad, and I was working at ESPN as an assistant producer, right? When a professor that I had in undergrad came in, looked me, found me, and told me that Ohio State was inviting me to come to a visitation. They paid for my trip, wined me and dined me, the whole thing, right? That was a transformative moment. It changed my life. I was already in a career, but I knew I wanted more, and I wanted to do something with education. But I was at ESPN. I would have stayed for a while. That was a transformative moment. And I wonder, Mr. Harris, if spending that time in the library and then meeting that recruiter, was that a transformative moment? And was that related directly to your time in the library?
Oh, I don't think there's any question. I mean, I would not have ended up at Notre Dame, most likely, if that connection had not been there. I think I would have applied, but the fact that I was able to meet the recruiter, network enough where they took a personal interest in me and my application, I mean, that was invaluable. And then helped turn around a year later and helped her get in.
And that's what I was going to say. Because of his connection, with Miss J and that library, I mean, I had it too, but in this situation, I got the benefit. I mean, you know, I was just doing it as a silly, at that time, 19-year-old, you know, not really realizing how I was opening, you know, opportunities for myself. I had no idea that I was doing. I just wanted to go because he was there, you know, and I was shocked that my parents let that happen, but they did. But because of Mrs. Jacobson and what she did, here we sit.
Right.
Here we sit with 5 degrees between us. I mean, think about that. A white woman from Kansas. I'm just going to keep saying that. With 2 black kids from the central city in Columbus, Ohio. Think about that.
And clearly our class probably sent more kids to school than Linden had before and since, in terms of any one particular class.
Wow, I feel like saying amen, but I'm gonna calm down.
Wow, yeah, that's incredible.
Yeah.
I mean, when you put it in perspective like that.
Right.
You know,
it's tremendous, and that class is a really unique and special class. This is my last question, because I've gone longer than I should have gone already, but I couldn't resist, forgive me. So then there's texts that we have all read, right? No doubt about it. For me, it was Malcolm X. It was transformative. I was annoying. I wanted to talk like Malcolm. I mean, my cousin's mom would understand. But I grew, and it challenged me. It changed me. I fasted for Ramadan. I started to travel the world. It changed my life. And I wanted to ask you, was there a particular text that was transformative for you, and was there a relationship for the both of you here in terms of leading you to get involved in the leadership at Linda McKinley, and then also with your life and careers?
I don't think there was one text for me. I think it's a compilation of many texts and many experiences that led me to where I am today. And many people, both black and white, who put their hands on me and said, you know what, there's something about you. I will remember that Jim Heyer, He was a superintendent in Columbus when I was an assistant, a high school assistant principal. He sought me out because he thought that I had leadership skills. He, a white man, thought I had leadership skills, and I ended up being, well, the youngest high school principal at that time that had been named in Columbus City Schools. He made me a high school principal, and then he made sure that I got in this publication, professional publication, as one of the 30 top administrators across the country to watch. And I'm just telling you, those kinds of experiences inspired me to know that I couldn't just sit on that stuff. I mean, I had to be in the mix, helping people get to wherever it is they wanted to get. I mean, I just couldn't, I couldn't just sit on my blessing. I just couldn't do, or the benefits that I received from so many blessings. So I think it's a compilation of reading, of experiences, of travel, all of those things that lead me to where I am today. And I just don't feel like I'm finished. I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do next, but I just don't feel like I'm finished.
Yeah, I would say that it's probably not been one book, but just a lot of stuff that I began to read at that time. But I would say Up From Slavery was probably the first eye-opener for me. And then I was fortunate my freshman year when I went to Notre Dame, I was able to take one of our Black Studies courses that was taught by a gentleman by the name of Dr. Joe Scott. And who was at that time head of Black Studies at Notre Dame. And it was, there were a number of books that we ended up reading across a whole array of subjects, all dealing with the Black experience. And that probably did more to shape my thinking at the time than anything else. But it was a series of books. But I came from a fairly conservative upbringing. Mm-hmm. The church that I grew up in really was not socially active at all. And that was a big question for me because I didn't think that was right. And then, of course, as I started reading and found that the Baptists and some of these other denominations were already out there doing stuff, and I couldn't understand why our church didn't do it. I mean, we didn't even promote voting. Something as basic as that. So it really did kind of light a fire under me to be active and to be involved. I've never been a guy that's been comfortable sitting on the sidelines. I never really thought that I would be a leader, but I found myself time after time after time being pushed to either do it, elected to do it, asked to do it, or whatever. So you just you're out there and you just do it. But the literature really opened up my eyes to a much bigger world.
Thank you. That was really powerful. I mean, you guys talked about windows and mirrors. I mean, all these little really interesting points that you talked about with books. And then there's something else I have to share with you. It's really interesting that two of my favorite units to teach are the Du Bois Booker T debate and the Great Migration.
Right.
And wow.
Really get engaged with that. It's really interesting.
You yeah.
mentioned it.
You should have him come as a guest lecturer.
I would love to do that.
He's awesome.
Because I have to tell you right now, I've got some real issues with the first chapter of Up From Slavery, where Booker T just seems to be excusing everything to make white people feel comfortable.
Right.
Even
right.
My dad break my mom, but it wasn't his
whatever.
Fault. Whatever. What did he say?
Accommodationalism.
It's basically, it wasn't his fault. It was slavery.
Yeah. Accommodationalism.
So that really just burns me up. And so I love to have students read that for themselves and see how he is, the Wizard of Tuskegee, is manipulating you even today.
Yeah.
When you read the text.
Yeah.
And when you teach, when you do the Great Migration, if you need some artwork, Jacob Lawrence's the Migration series.
Oh yeah.
When I lived in New York, there was a show of his sort of Lifetime retrospective at the Guggenheim.
Oh
and
wow.
They had all of them, and it was incredible.
I bet.
it was actually just mind-boggling.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
Because it was at the same time obviously historical, but his style was so avant-garde. It was incredible.
I totally agree with you. I use a few of the panels, but only a few. But that's my inspiration.
Yeah.
Right
there. Yeah.
Some of the panels came to Columbus, but I missed it.
Really?
I feel terrible about that. But yeah.
That's one of my bucket list goals. Well, before it gets to bucket list, is to own a piece, one of those. That's one of my So Simone, did you have questions for the?
Yes, I did. So I'm Simone Drake. I'm in the Department of African American African Studies, and
I feel like I've met you, Simone.
Yes, my dad is Eddie Poindexter.
Oh, okay.
We met, I think, at the last year. Jerry Saunders had
that luncheon. Yes.
Yeah. And my dad came with me, and he introduced us. But I didn't say much at the time. I didn't know I was going to be working on this then. So I actually grew up on 19th Avenue between Ontario and St. Clair until middle school. Then
mm-hmm.
we moved far east. When did Jackie Rawls go to London? She would have graduated a little ahead of you.
1969.
Right? Yeah.
We graduated in 71, and she graduated in 1969.
Okay. Because I went to Cause.
Did you go to Cause?
So
yeah. Yeah.
She was my principal, and then when I was, I went to Denison, and then I did my master's at Ohio State, and I substitute taught while I was at Ohio State. Like on Fridays or when I didn't have class. And I remember teaching at Linden and subbing at Linden and seeing her picture on the Wall of Fame.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no idea when I was at Cause that she was a Linden alumna.
Yeah.
So I grew up hearing the story and maybe seeing something in the yearbook or something, but hearing the story about my parents marching. But I had no context for it other than it was still close enough to the civil rights movement for me to have a memory of it. Or not to have a memory of it, but to connect.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of this cool thing, right? My parents marched and, but I didn't really know more than that, other than that it was far, because I know they said it was to Franklin Park, and I knew that nobody walked from Linden to Franklin Park.
Right.
And it wasn't until at the beginning of this year, I think, when my dad was taking a screenwriting class with Celia, and he had to write a script, and he wanted to write about that. And that's when I learned, really, like, the backstory and really what happened afterwards, because I would have never known. Hold on a second. Is that, can you hear that in the background, a lawnmower?
Mm-mm.
Sorry, I was outside. This doesn't matter so much for the recording, though, right?
No, it did sound like music, though, not a mower. It's a lawnmower. I can hear it as a lawnmower.
That man cuts his grass multiple times a week. He literally cuts his grass multiple times a week. So, but I was trying to go outside so my kids wouldn't be in the background. But anyway, so it's a special, you know, story for me, and really getting to hear the background, and then my department celebrated its 50th anniversary last fall. And I've been doing a lot of research around that. Well, and also, they're not treating my department right, so I've been doing a lot of research, too, just going into the archives and discovering that the department really hasn't been treated right since it was born.
Are you in the School of Social Work?
No. So Charles Ross, before he was in social work, was hired to be the first chair of my department, Black Studies.
Okay.
And that lasted for all of 1 year because of his involvement with what happened at Linden, and they removed him. And my department has basically been in a long 50-year history since then of various, I'll just say manipulations by the college,
mm-hmm.
by the university. I think the next chair after him, Nick Nelson, who you probably would have
mm-hmm.
heard of.
Mm-hmm.
He was the next chair. He was basically kind of removed as well, although it did take 15 years before somebody got bold enough to stand up to Nick Nelson. and so I've been going through like the newspaper archives and things like that. So Dr. Ross went on to move over to social work after.
Got it.
After they removed him.
Okay.
And after, I mean, he had a municipal trial, he had an OSU hearing, and it, you know, it was a big deal. And so I think, you know, this has interesting connections then with my department and social justice, as you know, and with school. But one thing that I came across, and that we haven't really heard much about, is the arrest of two white teachers. And I know one went on to be an administrator with Columbus Schools. So John Farley and Christina Boyles.
I forgot about that.
And she seems like she was probably young too. It was when the
oh my God,
they came to the aid of Tom Brown. So this was after the shutdown and things had reopened, I think, for seniors to take exams. And there was something else that came up. I think he was going to look for a student because the mother was ill in the office, and he didn't want the student to freak out. And there were officers in the building, and they wanted his ID, and he didn't have it on them. And so then they were trying to stop him from moving through the building, and that's when the teachers also jumped in. But I haven't heard anything about these teachers. I know I know for sure John was not back at the school the next year. He was moved elsewhere. But I did see through LinkedIn, and I found some video panels that he was on for some things with the schools, that he did end up becoming an administrator.
Yeah. John actually worked directly for me while I was superintendent, but I had forgotten about that because that actually happened, I think, after. Did that happen during our senior year?
Yeah.
Did that happen during our senior year?
It was in early June, so.
Okay, it was kind of the end of it.
If you weren't a senior, you probably weren't in the building anymore.
Right.
And if you were a senior, you were taking exams.
John, right. John went on to become a principal in the district. And then he worked in central office. I mean, when he actually worked for me and was on my cabinet while I was superintendent. So John retired during the time the 12 years that I was superintendent. And I think he still lives in Bexley.
Yeah.
Christina Voiles, she was married to Jim Voiles then. I think they got divorced. I really don't know what happened to her. I think she did continue a career as a teacher in Columbus City Schools, I think, and actually retired, you know, as a teacher in Columbus, from Columbus. Yeah. John's a good man. And he reminded me a few times that he was there. I think that was his first or second year teaching our senior year in high school. That's so funny.
Yeah. We had a number of young, very young teachers.
I forgot about that.
At that time, yeah.
And what was that like, having teachers who were quite young?
It was good because I became one of those. I mean, you know, when you just, I'll just say this real quickly. They were relatable.
Yeah.
When I graduated from Notre Dame and then came home to teach, I taught at Everett Junior High, 7th, 8th, and 9th graders. I taught there for 4.5 years, and then I applied for the administrative program, and then I was placed at Central High School in their last 2 years, and I was 26 or 27 years old.
Wow.
And so, you know, there's not really a whole lot of 18-year-old can tell you when you're 26, 27, because you were just 18 a few minutes ago. And so don't try that with me, because I'm not going there with you. But they were very relatable, and it was good to have. And they had energy. When I was 26 and 27 years old and 30 and in early 30s, I had a lot of energy. So I could run around school. I could be right there with you. My mind was sharp. It was really good.
But I think the other thing was, certainly back then, the whole idea of Black history, at least in Columbus, being taught as part of the curriculum in school, not necessarily separate, but being incorporated into the curriculum was very novel, and these young teachers were embracing that
they
kind of
willing.
Stuff. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think, you know, some of the more mature, experienced teachers might have found ways to skirt that.
Well, they might not have been comfortable with
yeah.
it at all.
Yeah.
I'm curious, this doesn't really have anything, I mean, to do directly with Lyndon, but what was it like going to Notre Dame? Are either of you Catholic?
No.
Baptist.
Okay. Okay. And it's in South Bend. And so I'm just curious what that was like, you know, in 71, 70,
well,
in the early 70s.
Yeah, and I think it goes deeper than just being a black student in a more or less lily white environment. What you had there was, I mean, you had Notre Dame, the vast majority of their students are the children of Notre Dame graduates, and sometimes the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren. I mean, it's deep. And
the wealthy children.
And I was going to say, and the wealth there is pretty vast. And so it was a person, at least for me, coming out of, you know, what is commonly referred to as poverty, walking into an environment where, you know, these kids had gone to private schools and you know, it was nothing for them to have a couple hundred dollars of an allowance every month. And if they needed more, it was just a matter of picking up the phone and asking dad for more money. I mean, I didn't have an allowance. I didn't even have $200 a year. to spend. So, you know, you're just walking into what is easily cultural shock. But, you know, you learn how to survive.
And I went there the first year that women were admitted. And so there were 8 black women on campus. And that was novel that year. And then it grew. But I think the experience... I had no idea that this was happening. The experience prepared me for a lot of things that I was going to face
mm-hmm.
As a professional and as a black woman. And while I would love to have gone to an HBCU, I think for the career that I chose and the pathway in my career as a superintendent of a major school district where there's still not very many black superintendents nationally, and there's even fewer black female superintendents nationally. And knowing that, you know, a lot of people think that when you're superintendent of school, all you have to do is deal with school people and all of that. Not true. You're in a very political and politicized position, and so you deal with the wealth in the city. You deal with the power brokers in the city. And so while I didn't know it then, it was preparing me for my career. It wasn't fun sometimes.
Wow. Do you happen to know what happened to those other 8 women? I'm sorry to interrupt, but I was really curious about that. Those other first black women.
I do not.
In Notre Dame.
Mm-mm.
That'd be an interesting question to find out.
Yep,
considering
I do not.
Your success, yeah?
Yeah?
And to be a part of that first group. It's interesting.
Well, I think those were my questions. I am writing a book on Columbus schools and integration.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I'm almost finished.
Oh,
so,
awesome.
Yeah. That's another reason why I've been in these archives so much is trying to look through that history, but a bit different than, and you probably know, the Getting Around Brown.
Oh, yeah.
That was really historical. I'm doing it from a different perspective, and I'm really looking at kind of like the legal cases besides Pinnock that led up to Pinnock,
mm-hmm.
and then looking at my own experiences too, starting in 1980, right after, a year after busing started.
Yeah.
So it's been fun writing it.
Well, I'm looking forward to reading it.
Yeah, I'll let you know once it's... I'm going to figure out where I'm going to publish it, if I'm going to go with an academic press or a trade press.
Yeah. I wish you would. I mean, I really... I'm looking forward to that.
Sounds like that would be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It brings in, like, I do stuff with art, like with visual art and music and film. And so there's sort of this cultural, the idea is that you aren't just educated in the classroom, that there are these other experiences that
right.
are kind of marking what's going on in the classroom and how you're being educated, you know, more broadly.
Yeah.
So it covers a lot of, I mean, it covers things like just like, I don't know, like finding our bodies ourselves on the basement bookshelf when I was growing up. Because that is a way of becoming educated, right?
Right.
It's like
yeah. Right.
This introduction, this book that I knew I probably wasn't, my mom was not
yeah.
wanting to be reading. yeah, but then we had like seventh grade Quest class that was some pilot.
Quest.
That was teaching.
Oh, wow.
Best things that I don't think any kids are getting in school anymore.
No, they're not. Quest.
So it's a very different approach.
Yeah.
Thinking about
yeah.
it than like the traditional historical.
Right.
But I will let you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Once it's in that published state.
Absolutely.
I'm going to put in my request for an autographed copy now.
Oh, I was assuming what I was
yeah.
getting at. That's what I was assuming.
Well, I've been letting my mentor read it, and she's like, some parts of this are funny. So, yeah,
well, we wish you good luck with it.
Thank you, and I'm really glad that we got to have the two of you come in and
yes.
add to this project.
Well, thanks to
yeah.
your dad. I mean, he told me the whole background when he called, the whole background in history and what had happened in his class at the Extension Center. And
yeah.
you said, Dad, we've got to do something with this. Yeah, he told me that whole story. So thank
okay.
you. Thank you.
Well, I'm really glad you participated, because at first I thought, well, I think that they need to be involved, but I don't know. I'm like, how am I going to get a hold of them?
who else has been involved
like,
with
well,
this?
I know her cousin, so I can.
I yeah.
like, okay.
Yeah, so
like
Doug Black.
Oh.
Yeah.
Who else have you guys interviewed?
Oh, boy, quite a few.
Oh, okay, good.
John Wells, John Whitaker.
Okay.
John Harrington.
Okay.
Valora Washington.
Dr. Washington.
Where is she now?
Diggs.
Tom Brown.
Oh, great.
Tom
really?
Brown.
Wow.
Yeah, Bruce Bunch, Gary Davis.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Al Young, Donald Vassar.
Oh, Lord.
Valora Washington.
My memory's over here.
Nice. Which name were you laughing at?
Donald Vassar.
And Al Young. Vassar and Young. Both of them. Both of them.
What was the white woman's name?
Joellen Smith. Oh, yeah. Masters. Masters was her maiden
yeah.
name.
Right.
Yeah.
She's made, right?
Uh-huh.
To answer your question, Mr. Harris, Valora Washington has now moved back to
Oh, okay.
She was in the D.C. area.
Right.
I believe.
Okay.
But she's back.
Okay.
Like this year, as of this year.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Okay.
So there were some other white students that backed out, right?
Yes. There
yeah.
There was one person who didn't respond, and then there's one who declined to participate. But we
the
may
coach.
Have...
Right.
I think
one of the people, the football coach, he has like an Italian name.
I think that's the one that didn't respond.
Oh, okay.
But Rita, I think her name is Young, is the one who declined. But we may have someone else. So
okay.
That Eddie connected me with. So
okay, cool.
Okay.
Thank you for bringing that up, Tuesday. Mr. Harris, I got to tell you that Rick Warren apology was huge. That was powerful. That was really powerful for you to share that, because Rick Warren, as you know, you had other friends on the football team. He had other friends as well.
Oh, yeah.
African-American
oh,
friends.
Yeah.
So there were many people, I think, that were surprised and hurt by his actions.
Well, it was totally out of character. And I mean, and everybody knew that. And I think Rick knew that that was totally out of character. So he was comfortable coming back in the way he was. When we saw him and apologizing, because that, I mean, nobody would have ever guessed that he would do something
Mm-mm.
like that. And then to explain that, you know, his parents had gotten involved and you know, they went through some changes with that. Yeah, it was it blew us away.
Did you ever see him at school again after that day? No.
No.
The
No.
No, he went to Brookhaven.
Yeah, he graduated from Brookhaven.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
You mentioned that too. And then, but what's interesting is that when some of the folks who followed them out of the building, chased them out of the building, saw him get away in the getaway car. So there were friends waiting for him.
Oh, yes. Yeah. This was staged. This was clearly staged. And he wasn't by himself. I mean, there were other students there that knew what was going to happen, and they were prepared to make their exit, and they did.
I see. But he was just this iconic name. It keeps coming up again and again.
Yeah.
So clearly a number of African-American students knew this guy.
Right.
And they liked this guy.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And this is what happens when wounds don't heal.
Right.
This is what, there's an infection. There's an infection. Mm-hmm. And it just hurts me.
And I'm not even sure, to be honest with you. I'd love to sit down and talk to him now about this, but I'm not even sure he really understood the ramifications of what he was doing.
He was 18.
At the time he did it. He was just led to be disruptive. And that was it.
He was 18.
Yeah.
And when your parents are telling you to do it, what do? You do it.
So his parents,
you do it, and usually you believe it.
So his parents involved themselves in school activities.
No, but with
did they direct explicitly say do that, or they just gave him the mindset?
We don't know. I mean, he just basically said, you know, my parents had influenced what we did. And so and he had to get the literature from somewhere. This was not just blank paper that
it was a printed document.
Yeah, it was printed document. It was racist. And again, somebody supplied that material with him. And I don't think he was by himself in terms of throwing the paper over the balcony. So yeah, I remember you asking me that, and I said, you know, I really don't know how many kids did it. We know there was at least one, but there probably were more than one. But they quickly, once they threw the paper over, they just immediately ran up the steps and came back down the steps and out the building. And a lot of the other white kids knew about the timing because they all got up and left. I mean, it was almost like that, you know, all the white kids got the memos and the black kids didn't, you know, leave at 9:30, you know.
Well, I'm sure that's exactly what happened.